the context of God's big story, we find ourselves in a particular moment. And that moment is something that theologians have called the already but not yet. So our salvation has been accomplished, but we work out our salvation with fear and trembling. Jesus has conquered sin and death, but we live in a world where we have to face sin and death constantly. And this happens not only in the world around us, but also in ourselves. And so because of this particular historical moment that we're in, we have to face suffering constantly. Small sufferings, big sufferings. Sometimes there are self-inflicted sufferings. We make choices that we probably shouldn't, and there are consequences that we have to face because of that. Sometimes suffering is inflicted on us by others, and then there's some suffering that just seems to be part of kind of a world that has gone awry, where things are not the way that they should be, where there are cracks in the system. And so in this life, characterized by having to encounter suffering, we can find hope in something that Paul told us a long time ago. In the book of Romans, he says that all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. So the interesting thing is that in this particular historical moment of the already but not yet, our suffering is commandeered against its will to the stronger will and higher purposes of a loving God. And I think that this is one place where psychology can helpfully jump into the dialogue by helping us to understand how in the world good can come out of suffering. Aren't suffering and flourishing opposites? What can one possibly have to do with the other? Isn't the point just to get away from suffering so we can flourish? And yet it turns out that in our fallen state, in our post-fall, pre-redemption state of affairs that we are in, suffering may simply be the most direct route to flourishing. And this is so clear that one secular psychologist who's done work on the connection between suffering and flourishing has called suffering the hard road to the good life. So what are the ways in which suffering can lead to flourishing? I'd like to suggest very briefly here that there are three pathways from suffering to flourishing. The first one is simply that suffering is sometimes a marker for sin. Sometimes suffering and hardship are self-caused because we have fallen into sin of some kind. And yet even in these circumstances, suffering has a redemptive potential by being a signpost that indicates that something has gone wrong. Just as physical pain can sometimes alert us to the fact that something is going wrong in our bodies, so other types of suffering can also point us back to places where we have gone astray and direct us away from those things. The suffering that results from various kinds of addictions, for example, is often a necessary wake-up call to addicts, motivating the person toward recovery. So that's the first way in which suffering can sometimes be a pathway toward flourishing. The second kind of good that results from suffering is that of virtuous character formation. Scripture describes actually various character traits that can result through suffering. So for example, James encourages believers to rejoice because suffering can result in maturity. And this word means kind of perfection or completion of character. There are also certain character traits, what we might call virtues in the Christian tradition, that if you stop and think about it, they only appear in the context of pain and suffering. So forgiveness, for example, is absolutely pointless if there is no sin. Wisdom is the skill of living well, and guess what? Living well requires no skill in paradise. So Paul explained that the suffering that he went through from his thorn was given to him for a very specific purpose that he might not have gained otherwise, to learn humility and to learn dependence on Christ. Findings from psychology confirm that suffering can lead to positive character change, and actually there's a ton of research on this, documenting change in people who have undergone all kinds of different suffering, life-threatening illness, rape and sexual assault, people who have been through wars and plane crashes and natural disasters, people suffering from a variety of mental illnesses. To give you just one example of this, there was a study that looked at people's character, self-reported character traits post 9/11. And they found that compared to people who responded to the same questionnaire in the general population pre 9/11, these folks after 9/11 reported greater intimacy, kindness, gratitude, teamwork, hope, and spirituality. And what I find especially interesting is that these researchers, as they looked at the traits that had increased over this period of time, These secular researchers noted that you can summarize these traits basically as the faith, hope, and love trilogy of Christian virtues. So the biblical and psychological data converge in suggesting that suffering can be an important way in which we develop character traits or virtues. The third pathway from suffering to flourishing is the one that I want to spend a little bit more time on, because it's the one that I think is potentially the most surprising or interesting, and it's that the changes caused by suffering might serve the purpose of reorienting us. They might modify our worldview. They modify the ways in which we make meaning of the world around us. Now, one of the consistent themes in Scripture has to do with the redirection of our thoughts and desires and attention toward the things of God. And it turns out that suffering can be an important way in which this happens. So I think it goes something like this. Directing our attention away from ourselves and our self-preoccupation is a really difficult task. We naturally come at things from a very egocentric, self-centered perspective. And so I think sometimes God uses suffering to capture our full attention. And once he has our attention, he teaches us a very important lesson that we might not welcome in the moment. I am God and you are not. And this is a hard lesson to learn, but I think it's a lesson that restores God and humanity back into their proper relationship. Psychological research on the kinds of change that occur after people have gone through trauma or suffering of various kinds also confirms this reorienting function of suffering. So people, for example, report that in the first place their relationships are changed in some way. They now value their friends and family more. They have increased compassion, feelings of altruism toward others. Second, people change their views of themselves in sometimes radically different ways. They might have a greater sense of personal resiliency or wisdom or strength, along with a greater awareness of their own vulnerabilities, their own limitations. And then finally, people report a change in life philosophy. So people might report finding a new appreciation for each day or renegotiating their priorities so that different things matter the most. Now, why is it that suffering can produce these kinds of reorienting changes in our meaning-making system? I think what happens here is that suffering often shatters the way that we made sense of the world before we encountered that suffering. And when we have all of the pieces just kind of drifting and floating around us, you know, when our worldview has been shattered, that's a great opportunity to put together the pieces in a better way, to put together the pieces in a way that where we can find the world more meaningful, where we can reorient it toward the way that God wants us to make meaning in our lives. And there's some interesting research that suggests that the more events are perceived as devastating, the more helpless and out of control that we feel, the more potential for growth. So the harder the suffering we go through, the more potential there is for this shattering and rebuilding of our meaning-making system. Our suffering sometimes shows us how fragile we are, how uncertain our future is, how little in our life we actually have control over. It shows us the limits of our human condition, our finitude, and brings into question our assumptions about ourselves. And adjusting this can lead us to recognizing our place before God and making sense of that. So in summary, suffering has the potential to be a spiritual pathway that leads us to flourishing. It can do this by turning us away from sin, by growing our character, and perhaps most importantly, by changing our view of the world and ourselves to one that is more meaningful and restores God to his proper place in our lives.